name is Mark Sheeland. I'm Director of Programs and Government Relations at the Middle East Institute. I'm very pleased to welcome you all to today's discussion under the title Political and Security Crises in Afghanistan, the Future of the National Unity Government. We're very gratified by the turnout, also by the media interest today. Thank you very much for being here. If you see empty seats to either side of you near the centers, please feel free to move in away from the aisles. We always have late arrivals, and we'd like to accommodate everybody in seats. There are quite a few open here to my right. This is an event in the Middle East Institute's Lewis R. Hughes Lecture Series. We are very grateful to Mr. Hughes, a member of MEI's Board of Governors, for his generous support of our programming on policy issues in Afghanistan. The issue today, you're hearing about the sustainability and the legitimacy of Afghanistan's national unity government, an issue that has been very much in the news, and it has powerful implications for, among other things, the future of U.S. and coalition military engagement. Before I introduce our moderator, I want to urge you all to take a look at MEI's website right after this event is over and register for a discussion tomorrow that MEI is co-sponsoring with Johns Hopkins SAIS, with the conflict management program there. Professor Emeritus Bill Zartman will speak on his new book, Arab Spring, Negotiating in the Shadow of the Intifada. The panelists joining Professor Zartman will be Alan Kieswetter and Ellen Lapson. Daniel Serwer will moderate the presentations and discussion. That event is tomorrow, Tuesday, May 3rd, from 4:30 to 6 p.m. There's information on mei.edu. Now, it is my pleasure to introduce the moderator of today's panel. Dr. Marvin Weinbaum is the director of MEI's Center for Pakistan Studies. Marvin is a distinguished scholar whose experience includes Fulbright research fellowships in Egypt and in Afghanistan. He directed the program in South Asian and Middle Eastern studies at the University of Illinois for 15 years, has worked in the Department of State as an intelligence analyst, and is a prolific author of articles and book chapters. Marvin saw the importance for U.S. interests of addressing our topic today, and he's recruited a panel of remarkable and diverse expertise to do so. So Marvin will introduce the panelists. He'll lead the conversation with them and with you, taking your questions over the coming 90 minutes or so. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you again very much for coming in today. Marvin, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mark. And please, as you can see, we have a good deal of media coverage today. So I ask you, please, to turn off your cell phones. Thank you. It's a pleasure that we have interest, but why should we be surprised? Because what is happening in Afghanistan today leads so many of us to say, is this a period of crisis? Now, we've all, those of us who have been following Afghanistan, we regularly say that we're entering some kind of period here of some decisive developments which are going to determine the future of the government and the state. But I think we would probably all agree that very recently there have been a number of developments which seem in this year who have created circumstances which lead us to believe that somehow we have reason to worry more about Afghanistan, again, about its government and about issues of security, the economy, and, of course, we want to address all of those today, and I'm sure we'll have an opportunity. Now, our format is not going to be a series of speakers, but rather that I will be posing a series of questions. And we will, therefore, be encouraging here among our panelists discussion. And we have a superb panel to do just that. To my right, Scott Smith, who most of you know for his time heading the Afghanistan program at the U.S. Institute of Peace. He's now left us for the UN, returned to the UN, where he is involved in mediation efforts, very befitting his skills. To his right is Omar Samad, who's also well known here, as well as in Afghanistan, and he is recently returned from Afghanistan after having been named as designate ambassador in Belgium. He's chosen, however, to join us, and we're pleased here. Omar has been ambassador to France, to Canada, and most recently has been a close advisor to Dr. Abdullah. Michael Kugelman, to his right, is another familiar face, they all are, here in Washington, with the South Asia program at the Wilson Center, and he has organized so many panels, and as you know from his own moderating of panels, how well he is able to address Afghanistan and Pakistan and South Asia in general. And finally, Ali Jalali. Ali has been in the past, has a long past with Afghanistan, which includes military service and was early in the Karzai administration, the Minister of Interior, but is currently a distinguished professor at the National Defense University here in Washington. But Ali is a very serious player in Afghanistan. So he's more than just simply an observer. He is someone who participates actively in the affairs of Afghanistan. And I don't know that we can have a panel, very honest with you, about Afghanistan today without having Ali Jalali join us. So with that as an introduction, let me start where I started. And that is to say, gentlemen, what makes this year different? What is now being posed by coming events, previous events, that suggests that we ought to be paying greater attention, perhaps, than we have for over the next few months? Gentlemen, I'd like to start us off. Ali?
Thank you, Marvin. Good to be here again, and pleased to share the panel with all friends. Now, in any country, any place, when we focus on the situation, you have to look first on the context. Context, political context, and security context of Afghanistan is changing. I can.
Okay.
Can you hear me now, or should I project? There are a number of issues, a number of factors that shapes the current situation in Afghanistan. First of all, the international forces left Afghanistan at the end of 2015, and that was the end of combat mission by the international forces. Second, Afghanistan has to deal with the security threats by its own capacity and own forces, Afghanistan National Security Forces, which are still in transition. Although the country has a sizable army and sizable police force, but it was developed as an dependent on international assistance, both financially and operationally. That dependence is still there. That's why until you have this capability gaps in the national security forces of Afghanistan, there will be a need for assistance from outside. Third, the Taliban and other insurgents and terrorists are using or try to exploit the situation of the departure of the international forces from Afghanistan and assuming that they can do better with the Afghanistan National Security Forces. Third is the economy. The economy of Afghanistan in the past, during the presence of the international forces, was dependent on international presence, actually, to some extent. 2 years, 3 years ago, the service sector of Afghanistan economy constituted 50% of the economy. With the departure of the international forces and also their contractors and others, that market, actually the service market, contracted. And at the same time, it caused unemployment and also a kind of a reduction of state revenue. And finally, in the region, some countries who believe that with the departure of the international forces, they can influence Afghanistan to an extent to get a better deal if there is a political settlement in Afghanistan. So therefore, the impact factor that shape current situation in Afghanistan has global, regional, and domestic dimensions. That's why Afghanistan is dealing with these threats now with its own capacity, with some assistance from the outside. I can go on.
Well,
on,
of course, I know you
this
can.
Is actually, the basic the factors.
Omar,
in order of age, if you want to look at it that way. Thank you, Marvin, for the invitation. I think that Minister Jalali's assessment is correct. I just want to look at it from another angle, and that is that today is shaped by what we've seen over the last 15 years, especially shaped by the transition of 2014, which was an extremely difficult, tough, and challenging transition on different levels, at different levels, both political, security, and economic. And there's a fourth level that people really do not talk about often, and that's the psychological transition that had to take place in Afghanistan, which we really did not manage very well, both Afghans and internationals. But then 2015 was expected to be the year of some level of positive change on all these different accounts. And 2015 turned out to be, to the dismay of many of us, and to the surprise of some, a very difficult year for the Afghan people to begin with, for the Afghan forces, the national security forces, for the newly formed and new experience of the National Unity Government in Kabul, for the economy that, as was mentioned, shrunk in the bubbles that burst after so many years of heavy involvement and investment in Afghanistan to keep that economy afloat, and we realized that part of it was artificial. And finally, the regional context has been shifting as well. We hoped for some real change and real strategic shift, especially with Pakistan, in regards to Pakistan. And for a while, we thought, well, a new government in Kabul, a new leadership, and Mr. Ghani's overtures might crack the nut. It didn't. And we are seeing that there's so much more that needs to be done, and it's not that simple and that easy. So the expectations that were developed over 2014 and before that, and I'm not going to dwell at this stage on how Mr. Karzai handled this transition and how what he left behind for the rest of us. But this transition obviously has not resulted in what most of us expected. Some of us saw some of the fault lines and tried our best to convey that and express that and try to find some ways to mend them and to correct the course. Some of us were a bit too optimistic. Some of us heightened expectations at the very beginning for unnecessary reasons, and they are paying a political price for all of that today. So all of these things are going on at the same time in a very short period of time, given a government's lifespan. And today we are talking about how fragile is this government, how fragile is Afghanistan, what will happen next? Should we talk about alternatives? Should we talk about plan Bs and Cs and so on and so forth? We can discuss and this further later on. But I will. This is sort of, in a nutshell, what I see, how I see things shaping up.
Scott?
Yeah, I mean, I think that Omar is entirely right. I'll just rephrase or sort of state it in a slightly different term. I don't know that Afghanistan in 2016 is any more fragile than it was in 2015 or even in 2014. But I think what has changed, and it's particularly relevant from the perspective of where we sit in Washington, is we've come to the end, I think, of our wishful thinking. What we learned in 2014 and 2015, I think, now convinces us that the dynamics within the national unity government are not going to significantly improve. The Taliban are probably not going to come to the negotiating table anytime soon. Pakistan is probably not going to be able to push the Taliban to the negotiating table anytime soon. The Afghan national security forces are not going to be the miracle that we had hoped and to some degree convinced ourselves that it would be. And elections will probably not happen in 2016. So that sort of leaves us with no real way out of what was supposed to be the beginning of an emergence of the slightly abnormal constitutional situation that we're in now. So that's why we're sort of looking at alternatives and plan Bs and so forth, because I think we've run out of all of the optimistic scenarios that we had once had. And that's what I think is sinking in and making 2016 a particularly challenging and different year, even though the fundamentals may not really have changed that much.
Michael.
Yeah, thanks, Marvin. I'll keep this brief. I imagine we're going to be discussing how things are getting worse, dark days ahead, et cetera, which is true. But you know, just to start off with a bit of context, I mean, as this audience would know in particular, that things are bad, but it's not all bad. And for example, there are plenty of people that didn't expect the National Unity Government to get as far as it has now, but obviously it has. And also for all the talk of a deepening Taliban insurgency. I mean, the Taliban has suffered setbacks, including just the other day in Kandahar. There was a major operation that killed several dozen Taliban fighters. And you also have had Afghan special forces that have really been distinguishing themselves on the battlefield. So I think that's important to keep in mind. That said, I would just highlight very briefly three changes that are really making existing challenges more difficult to deal with. One, and this was alluded to, there's just a new urgency. A new sense of urgency pervading politics in Afghanistan because of the National Unity Government's founding agreement, which stipulated that a number of things happen by a certain time, specifically September of this year, and they haven't happened yet. So one could argue that there's a clock is ticking type dynamic that could amplify the fractious nature of the political environment in Afghanistan now. Secondly, there have been some significant Taliban tactical victories that amplify the vulnerabilities of Afghan security forces, like the brief takeover of Kunduz not too long ago. And third, you have quite a few Afghans who are leaving the country, including from the educated middle class. And I think that these types of problems, these are things that happened in the past, and they're starting to happen again today. And I think it's difficult to start to deal with the deeper challenges that Afghanistan faces when a number of your best and brightest are headed for the exit.
Thank you. Let's look specifically at the National Unity Government, which was formed a little over a year and a half ago, and has another 3.5 years the term in office. How have these developments that we've been talking about specifically affected the possibilities of survival of this government? By all accounts, Ashraf Ghani's very popular beginning here has eroded. Reportedly we hear that there's a lack of confidence now, which has grown. In answering this, I wonder if we could address what it is that he could have done differently, and indeed, what can he now do to assure the survival of this government for another 3.5 years? Omar?
having spent almost a year and a half within that unity government, I'm unfortunately not at liberty to say too much, but to give you some perspective, I can say that I think this was meant to be. You know, I don't want to go into the why it came about. Everyone has their own theories and how it came about. We'll leave that to history to judge at one point or another. But once it came about, it was meant to follow a certain recipe and a certain set of guidelines. And it hasn't. And for those of us who have been inside the system, we know by now why and what are the motivations. Some of it is very distressing. Some of it has to do with petty politics, petty power struggles, and some of it has to do with real issues and substantive issues that have created this sense of a disunited government and not a united government or unity government. It was supposed to be a political marriage of sorts in the modern sense. But it, one side is playing a very traditional sense role in this marriage, traditional in the Afghan Eastern context, trying to dominate, trying to push, trying to impose. And the other side is trying to, again, probably in the Eastern sense, trying to accommodate, trying to be flexible to the extent possible, given its own political limitations. And you have to realize that this is not just a marriage between two individuals or two parties or two factions that fought in the elections. They are made up of a conglomerate, each one. And so this is very difficult to handle. They try to bring everyone under the tent with very few exceptions. And they thought that this is going to be sort of a Loya Jirga government. It can't. A Loya Jirga government doesn't work. But it was the only alternative. The sad part, the tragic part, is that there was no other alternative but to create such a unity government with the two top vote getters, the two individuals who legitimately had received the largest amount of votes in the country. Whether one was more or less than the other, that's another issue. But now that once we had it, and once it was sort of ratified, and the Afghan people accepted it, the international community put a stamp of approval on it, I think, again, there was a mistake of letting this government sort of find its own way, thinking that they know best, and that they know all the problems and have all the solutions. And especially the president has always given this impression that he knows all the problems and he has all the solutions. And he knows all the answers to all the questions. And this came back to bite them, especially the president, because people had this image that had been promoted and this image that had been created over the years that, you know, somebody mentioned something very interesting to me. They asked me a question, whether is he really a modernist? Is he still tribal? Is he post-tribal or is he still tribal? And I thought, you know, I had never thought about this, but this is a very interesting question for an Afghan. And I think it's a mix of both. When he sits here, he's modern and post-tribal. When he goes back there, he's tribal, but too much tribal, that even the majority of Afghans today cannot totally connect with him. And I think this is why we couldn't find the balance that was needed, the equilibrium that was needed in order to make this a more functioning government. Again, I agree with Mr. Kugelman that not everything about the national unity government is bad. And there was no other option at the time. And even today, I'm of the view that we shouldn't be looking for a revolutionary alternative, something that would further destabilize Afghanistan and would sort of put us in a very difficult situation, politically speaking. I think that we should do everything. There's still time, I think, to try everything possible, to use all means possible to impress upon the leadership of this government. And I think this is what John Kerry tried to do a few days ago, and impress upon the Afghan political elite and the Afghan people that we need to stay the course, but we need to correct the course. And we need to realize, we need to learn some hard lessons from the past year and a half. both in terms of governance, in terms of our relations with the international community, in terms of how we connect to the Afghan people, and how we play politics. I think that one of the biggest problems, and I will say it very openly, is that we have amateur politicians. We really do not have professional politicians who know how to even play politics in Afghanistan. The best example of a politician that we have is Hamid Karzai. Why? Because the guy, you know, you walked into the room and he would tell you everything that you wanted to hear, but he didn't believe in it. That was his problem. And you left the room and somebody else came, said the total opposite, and he would again agree with him. And when he left the room, you know, he continued doing the same thing. So this we think is a good politician. It is not. Again, Ahmed Karzai was a total failure, in my opinion. So we need to learn the lessons from the last, now going back 15 years, but especially the last year and a half. Okay.
So. Scott.
Yeah, I mean, one of the interesting paradoxes of this government of national unity is that there's a much more significant and organized opposition to it than there was to the government of Hamid Karzai, which I guess was, you know, a government of singular powers, you know, run by one person. The other thing is, what is our responsibility for this government? Because I think Omar is correct that after a bruising election, a difficult negotiation over putting this government together, a transition that was not so well handled, and an economy that was tanking, we sort of set the government with all of its internal frictions up and said, all right, now you guys take care of this. When the Iraq war was being debated in 2003, I think it was Colin Powell who coined the pottery barn rule, where he said, look, if we go in and we break it, then you own it. I think with power sharing governments is the opposite. If you fix it, you own it. And that's what I think carries, you know, the VTCs we hear about with the president, carries repeated visits to come back and try and get these guys to work together. To the specific questions of what could be done differently or what can be done, a lot of us have been advocating for a long time that obviously the two leaders of this government, if they're not able really to work together, at least project that they're working together. But I think for a variety of personality reasons and the internal dynamics and the roles of the factions on both sides, this hasn't happened. And as I said in my previous comment, I don't think it's likely to happen. But I think there are some things regarding strategic communications. There have been some successes that have been achieved. And it's always, you know, people like us and panels in Washington pointing out these successes, not the government itself through its strategic communications unit, that is letting Afghan people know, you know, what have we done, what are we attempting to do, and here's how you'll see we're sort of getting there. And I think that a lot of the frustration with this government is the sense that it doesn't understand the sense of crisis that Afghans themselves feel, all of the uncertainties, and therefore doesn't respond to them. And that's what helps power, in large part, this opposition that otherwise is made by, as you say, sort of a lot of politicians that aren't so good. They just happen to be in the position of being in an opposition to a government that seems even worse.
Thank you. Michael.
Yeah, picking up on the point, the good point that Scott makes about this government not necessarily acknowledging the crisis that it faces, I'll take the very specific question of what the president could perhaps do to strengthen his position. And quite frankly, there's in some ways not all that many options that one can come with. But in my view, you need to look at, there are two issues here. One is how the president can strengthen his position more broadly in the eyes of Afghans, the international community, and so forth. And secondly, how he can strengthen his position more narrowly in the eyes of his own government and his opponents within it. To strengthen his position in the broader context, I think there needs to be some effort to articulate a clear plan of action for the coming months and articulate, for example, how he intends to answer all these questions about time frames for local elections, Loya Jirgas, et cetera. So in effect, I think he needs to try to reduce some of these high levels of uncertainty that predominate now, because I think uncertainty breeds concern and elevates volatility. In terms of strengthening his position in the more narrow context, that's a lot more difficult. Perhaps one suggestion, though maybe this is asking too much, is for him to offer a clear assurance to Abdullah that the CEO position is intact, and that even if Loya Jirga does not meet to address the issue of what to do about the CEO position, that his position is still intact. Because I think there's just something to be said for clearing the air. Again, it may be asking too much, but I think that's a start.
Ali, did you want to discuss that.
Yes, you know, many years ago in, it was 2004, I believe, we faced a difficult situation in the country. One respected international figure told us, suggested something, which we thought it was against the Afghan constitution, newly approved constitution in 2004. And we argued that it is going to go against the constitution. He said, you're a poor country, you don't need a constitution. Now we face, again, something else. What we have today, it has its own problem in the inception. You have the... In the history of Afghanistan, in many cases, there was a tendency to solve difficult problems by tactical, you know, and then solutions. Another example of it. During the election, I think I was one of many others who said that count this the votes 100 times under international UN supervision and eventually announce one winner, the winner that will be accepted by. That was not done. Anyway, today in Afghanistan, coalitions are fine, but coalitions are successful only when they can balance two things, maintain unity and govern effectively. If you maintain unity at the expense or at the cost of effectiveness, you fail. If you want to be effective, but it actually undermines unity, again, what we have today is there are two leaders. One is the president. The other one is second among equals. What is it? And while the president gets his power from the constitution and appoints the or give or deliver some of the authorities to the second among equals, the second among equals does not have a strong standing on the basis of the constitution. So what he uses is political clout. So it turns into an opposition within the government. That's the major problem that was from the day one. Well, I think it was both of the leaders did a lot of sacrifices, made a lot of effort for this unity government to work. However, they are not alone. They have a camp. Both have people around him who helped them to bring them to win the elections. The election, the vote was not based on to make a difference. It was based to win the elections. So they, both sides, actually depended on borrowed constituencies. In these borrowed constituencies today have their demands. And that slows down everything. All decisions of Afghanistan in a country that is facing security, economic, political, name it, any kind of problem. Just a theme park of problems there. In that case, you have that kind of government. That's the problem. However, it does not mean it's not going to work. In Afghanistan, many, many difficult situations actually enabled Afghans to survive. And it depends on, it relates to very, very resilience capacity of the Afghans. They can manage issues. So I'm not saying that the government will fail. It will not fail. And somehow, however, the more they put effort in order to make it one government, integrate all their assets that they have into one government, it is not into, in other words, instead of making it a salad bowl, make it a melting pot of all elements. Today, it is a salad bowl. Whose minister belongs to that, and which ministers belong to that guy? And which ministry is reporting to that guy, and which ministry report? It is not one government. Unless you make it one government, and it making a melting pot. It is hard. But that is the way to make that government effective and successful.
Omar, did you want
to? Just to add a bit more to this discussion, if we are going to take the route of the Constitution itself, and what is constitutional, what is not, what constitutes legitimacy, so on and so forth, then we have to be very careful because we can open many cans of worms that we have seen, experienced over the last few years, especially in 2014, especially in how the election was handled, especially in how much fraud was orchestrated. That is also constitutional or anti-constitutional. If we want to talk about political opposition within the government, knowing that there is a lot of political opposition outside the government, we have to look at exactly, you know, what happens on a daily basis. Again, I told you earlier, I can't get into that. But I will tell you, there are probably individuals who act as political opposition within the government, but the motivation and the aspiration and the wish of the leadership is not, and I'm talking here on the Abdullah camp side, has been to work with the presidency and the president within the confines of that political agreement that was signed in September of 2014. There's a political agreement that is being trampled on a daily basis upon and is being ignored that they all signed on. There's a list of more than 100 high officials, from deputy ministers to ambassadors to the mayor of Kabul to the head of the Institutional Reform Commission, and so on and so forth, high-level positions that are awaiting final approval by the president for the past 16 months. Or 14 months, or 12 months, because someone somewhere does not want to see them, see these individuals, and the president has asked to interview every single person in person, from the position of deputy governors to district police chiefs, even further down. He wants to interview every person in person. When you have this kind of governance style and you have hundreds of people waiting to be appointed for the past year or more, obviously you're going to face a crisis, and there's no space for blaming one side or the other. One side has done its job, the other side has to do its job as well. So, I mean, we can go on and on about examples of what happens on a daily basis within that government. And who is accommodating, who is not, who is playing petty politics, clannish politics, and who is taking the, you know, a larger look at what is good and what is bad for Afghanistan. Our hope, every Afghan's hope, is that we would be driven by national interest, not clannish interest, not factional interest, not personal interest, as was the case under Mr. Karzai for so long. The hope is that we will broaden our minds in the scope of what we do and how we do it.
During 2016, there were to be two processes, political, constitutional. One, an election for a new parliament, and the holding of a Loya Jirga, grand council, which would could do a number of things, but was expected then to take up the issue about whether there would be a prime minister position created, as was proposed, as was in agreed to, I should say, when the government was formed. As you know, Dr. Abdullah is designated as the chief executive. So I want to ask the panel, what are the probabilities of these two processes going ahead? What are some of the obstacles? And what are some of the consequences should they not be completed in this year? Michael, did you want?
Sure, if I can start.
Well, there's the quick answer and there's the longer answer.
Let's all keep our...
So well, right, that's true. Sorry. Here's the quick answer. The idea of holding local elections within the next few months, to me, would appear to be nothing short of a miracle, just for a variety of reasons. I mean, when there were presidential elections the last time around, there was much more time to prepare for them. The Taliban was not as strong then as it was now, and yet, at this point, you're being asked to do something in just a mere few months. The Loya Jirga issue, I'm not a lawyer, so I'll refrain from getting into the legalese and so forth and so on. But I think what's the crux of the matter there is that the founding agreement, the political agreement that formed the National Unity Government, explicitly says that you need a Loya Jirga to happen in 2 years. But understandably, it does not spell out the consequences of not holding one in 2 years. And it's silent on the issue of how long the National Unity Government is to last for. So the agreement does not say that the National Unity Government is null and void if there's no Loya Jirga. I think that this issue of what can happen if the elections don't occur, if the Loya Jirga doesn't occur, it comes down to one of two interpretations. One, you could look at this from a very fundamental legal or business perspective and contend that when any two parties enter into a contract and fail to achieve what the contract stipulates must be achieved, then you can argue that the parties have breached the contract and the whole thing is null and void. That's one interpretation. The other is simply one of an argument of omission, that this political agreement does explicitly say that you need to have a Loya Jirga in 2 years, but it does not explicitly say that the government must fold if that doesn't happen. And I'm not a lawyer, so in terms of what interpretation is proper, I'm not in a position to say.
But that was the short version.
Yes.
Ali?
I think there are two issues to take into consideration. One is the technicality of the review of the Constitution and bringing changes so that the other one is the term of this. The election of Afghanistan was held for 5 years. So this government was elected for 5 years. There is no constitutional problem that this government continues for 5 years. Because people voted for this government. The leaders who are now in the helm of this government got the votes from people, assuming that this government will be in 5 years. However, in order to respond to the problems that occurred during the election, the fraud in the election and votes, in order to bring together these two people who had a majority of votes into a government, that's some kind of arrangement was made. Arrangement that to make this government work. I think if that Loya Jirga cannot be held in September or next year, or if the parliamentary election does not take well, that will be a problem. The government should deal with it. However, what actually delegitimizes a national unity government is not this. It is its effectiveness. Effectiveness. Because the legitimacy of this government did not emanate it from the very clear-cut winning, a result of the ballot boxes. It emanated from a deal that its legitimacy depends on its effectiveness. If it does not act effectively, then they have a problem. Not that if they Loya Jirga, is not, be convened in September or not. That's not a problem. It does not undermine the term of this government, which is for 5 years, because people voted for 5 years. Constitution gives it that term, 5 years. But the Loya Jirga elections, all these other things, review of Constitution, is something that helped this government to function effectively. If that does not happen, then this is the problem for the legion.
Yeah, since I started working on the first Afghan election in around 2003, I've always been bothered by the totally unrealistic timetables we've always set for ourselves. And we got away with it in 2004, 2005. When I saw the agreement that was negotiated, this is September agreement, and one day I hope the history books will look at this, you know, I was absolutely appalled. Whoever negotiated this agreement put in place a series of processes that could not possibly be held within the timelines that were supposed to hold them, which meant that it was doomed to fail from the beginning. And that's partly why we're in the situation that we're in now. I don't know why anybody thought we would be having district council elections this year when district council boundaries haven't been able to be drawn for 15 years. Why we would be able to get electronic IDs issued to every Afghan citizen when that hasn't been able to be done in the last decade of an attempt. So what do we do? I agree there's a legal case and a political case to be made that this government lasts for 5 years. But for once, why don't we actually take the 3.5 years that remain and set up an agenda that allows you to do a reform which is not compressed, that allows you to plan an election that can be feasible in that time, and look at it as a chunk of 3.5 years instead of the next 6 months, the next 6 months, the next 6 months, where we always fail to achieve anything, and we'll find ourselves in May of 2019, you know, with no electoral preparations done because we didn't take a longer viewpoint. That's what I would do, and provide the assurances, which actually are legal. There's a decree that says that the powers of the chief executive are not transferable. Provide the assurance to Dr. Abdullah that nothing's going to change in those 5 years, and let's get the country back on a much more rational path towards an election and a return to constitutionality.
Omar?
Yes, I mean, obviously, we got sort of sidetracked and derailed by a lot of different events, and we didn't stick to the agenda and to the timelines. There's been a concerted effort to play the delay tactic to prevent the Election Reform Commission to be formed, first of all, for them to do their work properly. You know, I was part of all of this on a daily basis, you know, dealing with these issues. These issues could have been dealt with within the time frames that were allotted to them if there was political will. This goes back to political will, not to whether 3 months is enough or not, or 6 months is enough or not. And also it goes to this very critical question of how much do we want to rock the boat, the political boat in Afghanistan, and when do we want to rock it? And look at what happened. The president's first item on his agenda was his overture to Pakistan. It was not to put the country back, the political structure back in place. It was to go to Islamabad in Rawalpindi. And we thought that, and remember, it was announced that by March 2015, we would have peace talks taking place. Then, instead of peace talks, we had suicide bomber after suicide bomber after suicide bomber hitting Afghanistan and all places. We had all those bad Taliban and bad foreign fighters who had been pushed inside Afghanistan throughout 2013, 14, and 15, who had set up shop, who already were ready. There was a strategy to basically take over as much territory as they could in 2015. It was the Afghan security forces and our international allies who basically put a stop to that. Yes, we lost a few places here and there, but the strategy was to gain a foothold beyond the districts and take over a few provinces. That has not happened. So this distraction took place in 2015. And then there was not enough political will to implement the accord. Even today, yesterday I received a note from Kabul saying, we go to them every day saying, okay, the next step is the selection committee, which is supposed to look at who is supposed to be and under what conditions and what criteria is supposed to be used and what is the legal framework for the next election commission, independent election commissions. Very important. Because we saw what the former election commission did. And there is no political will to move forward, one side or the other. So it's not, it's easy to blame, you know, time when you know that the game is something different. So let's, game or not,
from a technical perspective, I really think it's not a question of political will. These things could not have been done in 3 or 4 months. And if we keep thinking like that, we're going to keep making the same delays. And we won't start electoral preparations when we need them,
Scott,
until it's too late for
Scott,
them to happen.
We had 5 years between 2009 and 2014 to fix the elections. And some of you guys who worked on it are here. What kind of election did you guys prepare for Afghanistan? Where did all this money that the USAID and DFID and others spent on democracy building and electioneering and how to make this election look, where did it go and what did it produce?
Okay.
So let's, you know, that's how the Afghans see it. Easy to say that we can blame time, but the Afghans saw what happened within the 5 years that you had to fix the Afghan elections after the 2009 travesty, and it wasn't fixed.
In the time remaining, let's switch gears just slightly. Maybe major shift, by looking at the fact that, as pointed out here, we don't have a peace process in the works. It now seems as if it's post-peace process, and we're looking at some of the consequences of that. And one of those seems to be that the bright days of cooperation between Pakistan and Afghanistan have seem far behind us now. The president delivered an address to the parliament just very recently, which, although he didn't entirely close the door, indicated now that he certainly, if he hadn't closed it with the Taliban, he probably had closed it with Pakistan. So relations with Pakistan have certainly deteriorated. So I want to ask the panel, what are some of the implications of what could amount to a real breach in relations with Pastan? And in addressing that, also to say, is there anything that the United States or the international community can do to alleviate what might be a serious development? And for that matter, going back to the earlier discussions, is there a role for the United States and the international community more generally in stepping in on the political side as well, having done so many times, do we have any cards left to play here? So, gentlemen, Ali.
First of all, let's note that process or talks, peace talks, are a means, not a goal. If it can help bring peace and stability to Afghanistan, fine. Otherwise, it's not a goal. It is, Afghanistan faces security threats and stability, and there are two ways to respond to them. One is to do things, to use means to reduce the level of threat and security. The other means is to build the capacity to respond to the threat. Some time, they go hand in hand. I think it is good. I think it will be very good to have a peace talks and then reduce the level of threat. However, there are many complications to it. On the other hand, the longer the Afghan state survives, the less chance the Taliban will have to have their way. So whether the priority is to support the survival of the Afghan state or beg others to help us to bring some kind of a political settlement, whether it is, acceptable or not acceptable to majority of the people. This is the issue. This is the problem. I think the first thing Mr. Samad referred to it, that Ashraf Ghani went to Pakistan first because he thought that without relations, better relation with Pakistan, it would be difficult to bring Taliban to a kind of a negotiation. So Pakistan was the. When he went to Pakistan, he had three demands from Pakistan. First, end this undeclared war between Afghanistan and Pakistan, which is going on for 15 years. First, this should be done, or some indication should be presented that this undeclared war is going to be over. Once this is done, then Afghanistan can establish normal relation with Pakistan on other issues. And when that is, over time, maybe we'll have other specialized relationship, political, economic, security, and others. Well, that did not happen. I think Dr. Ghani told me he had given Pakistan until March of that year, 2015. It didn't happen. And then 2 months later, Pakistan, I think, tabled another kind of a package. But they want everything as one package, which is not acceptable. It was not acceptable to Afghans. So as long as this difference of approaches are there between Afghanistan and Pakistan, it will be difficult to ask Pakistan to help and bring the Taliban to negotiate. So what is the other option? The other option is build the capacity of the government, of the armed forces, to respond to the threats over time, to convince the Taliban that they are losing and they will come to the negotiating table. Afghans lost two opportunities to have peace under a kind of a favorable conditions. One was in Bonn, 2001. When Taliban were excluded, although 85% of the Taliban were ready to join the political process. It was a civil war, two sides. And a civil war ends either one side defeats the other, or they make a peaceful agreement. Neither one happened. And one side actually was removed from power but not defeated. The other the opportunity was 2003. When the Taliban approached the government, approached the different elements in the government that they wanted to. And at that time, neither the international community nor the Afghans were ready to do that. Now, this is the Taliban crime. They may lose that opportunity now. The longer the state survives, the less chance they have to come back. Therefore, I think priority is not to do everything in order to bring Taliban to the negotiating table. The priority is to build the capacity in the government with the international community so that this will force the Taliban to come to the
table. We do want to leave time for the audience to participate in this, so I'm going to ask the panelists, although the question that I offered was a very broad one, if you can limit your remarks. Michael, did you?
Yeah, I mean, when it comes to the peace process, it all comes down to the Taliban. The Taliban will be willing to sit down to talk when it has an incentive, and it simply does not have an incentive right now. If it were to be beaten back significantly on the battlefield, and if it felt like it were on the defensive, then it would have reason to come to the table, but I don't think we're at that point now. You know, I certainly think this QGC process, this quadrilateral peace process, is for all intents and purposes dead. But the idea of a peace process is not dead altogether. But certainly it's off the table for now, for the foreseeable future. I think that the issue of what role the United States could play is useful, and I don't think that's been brought up yet. I mean, I'll say this: I'm a bit more optimistic about Washington's ability to address reconciliation within Afghanistan than between Afghanistan and Pakistan. I've always thought that the idea of U.S. leverage over Pakistan is somewhat of a myth. With Afghanistan, it's a bit of a different story. I mean, the U.S. is a net provider of security and economic assistance. And in a way, in a context where the levels of dependence on U.S. support are significant. And of course, as we discussed, the U.S. government helped get Afghanistan out of its election crisis a few years back. And I imagine that if things get tricky down the road over the next few months, that we can assume that John Kerry, in his last few months in power, will make Kabul a fairly frequent destination. I imagine that President Obama at this point in his tenure is in a legacy stage, and I imagine he will not want to be remembered for failing to keep Afghanistan's government from falling apart. He won't want to leave office knowing that during his last few months in office, an Afghan government that he really helped put together ended up falling to pieces. So I don't want to overstate the ability and really the desirability of the U.S. to be getting involved in this type of thing. It's probably better for it to step back. But I think that there certainly can and should be a role for the U.S. and the broader international community to play.
I just want to say that, again, I think we have had a lot of lessons learned along the way on the Taliban, on Pakistan's role, on the geopolitics of the region, on the history behind this. The Taliban are now 22 years old. And I think this undeclared war, in my opinion, didn't start in 2001. It started in 1992. And it wasn't really, it was part civil war or factional war. It wasn't civil war because it wasn't like the ethnicities were all against each other and the masses were fighting each other. Afghanistan, unfortunately, has never experienced such a disaster because I think there is a strong core, a strong unity core within the Afghan identity. I think that from the very beginning, it was pretty obvious that there are geostrategic and geopolitical objectives that have to be met once the Soviets left and the communist government fell. And the biggest and most powerful player left there was Pakistan, who had handled and managed for a decade or more the billions of dollars that had come through Pakistan to be distributed to the Afghans to fight the Soviets. And it had gained so much leverage. And everybody, you know, I mean, this is not a question in Afghanistan. This is plain as the sun and the moon and the sky. And we are, what we are seeing is the continuation of that policy, unfortunately, in different shades. Yes, the shade changed after 2001. It took on a different image or exterior. And again, maybe at 2014 to some extent. But I don't think anyone in Afghanistan believes that the core strategy behind Pakistan's use of proxies to control at least our security and foreign policy is in any doubt. If it is still in Washington, I'm aghast. I would be very, you know, disappointed to think that people in Washington or London still think that Pakistan has some other motivation. So let's call a spade and let's deal with it in that context, not under illusions that don't make sense. So I think what the president should have done, and I'm not against overtures, by no means. I'm, you know, as a diplomat, I am for overtures, I am for talks, I am for dialogue. But we have to be ready for that. You have to be ready to speak as a stakeholder and as a party to any talks and negotiations. You have to have a strategy. Where was the strategy at the end of September 2014? There was one. I know there was one. But it wasn't shared with the Afghan people. And it didn't have the Afghan backing. And this is why it has not resulted into anything, in anything. So what we need to do now is regroup. Politically speaking, we need to reunite the Afghans around an idea and something that's workable and practical in terms of our relations with Pakistan, our issues with Pakistan. in terms of our defenses. Yes, Mr. Jalali is right. We need to bolster our defenses, and this is where the United States and others have a major responsibility and a role to play to make sure that the Afghan people are protected by our forces and our forces are protected by whatever is needed, whether air or land or intelligence, and that it's not just, you know, easy talk. It has to be demonstrated. And this is why I think that the next American administration, whoever may be the winner, has to look at it from a perspective of what works, what have we learned, what to do and what not to do. How do we bring durable and real peace to Afghanistan that has the backing and support of the Afghan people? If there are Taliban, Afghan Taliban, who are willing to lay down their arms and stop killing their fellow Muslims, forget about Afghan, which happens on an almost daily basis, let's not fall for the slogans of ethnicity, ethnic linkages, and regional linkages, and so on and so forth. Those things are finished. They have passed the test of time and did not amount to anything. Taliban, I remember, at one point used the former King Zahir Shah as their symbol or as their spiritual leader to make advances in Afghanistan in the 1990s. Why? Because he had some recognition and he was somewhat popular. People had a good memory of his reign. As soon as they took Kabul, they said that if they ever get a hold of Zahir Shah, they will hang him. They did the same thing with Mr. Karzai, and they're doing the same thing with Mr. Ghani in the name of Pashtun Brotherhood, or whatever people think they are doing or not doing. So going forward, we need to have learned the lessons, in my opinion.
For a moment there, I thought you were going to suggest building a wall.
Not at all.
Scott, why don't you wind this up? And
I'll wind it up very briefly by pointing out a quote I think that Barney Rubin had recently made, which is that, you know, there's a conflict about the conflict in the sense that we don't have a shared vision of who's actually part of the conflict and therefore who can be a mediator. And Barney pointed out that for us in the U.S., the conflict is mostly between Afghans, the government and the Taliban, and maybe we can mediate that. President Gandhi said the conflict is between him and Pakistan. The Taliban said the conflict is really between them and us because their main demand is to get us out of there. Pakistan says, you know, the conflict is really with India, and you know, Afghanistan is a strategic front in that conflict, but that's where the, you know, the weight of the resolution has to lie. So that is, you know, a very brief way of, you know, pointing out one of the real challenges and part of, you know, why we haven't been able to get this off the ground, without getting into the details of you know, the divisions also within the Taliban and the point Michael made about incentives. I mean, right now, the biggest issue that they disagree on is over whether to negotiate or not. So to push them towards negotiation is to push them towards fracture, and I think right now that's just not going to happen.
Thank you, Scott. Let me ask you, as you ask to be recognized for question, please keep those questions short. Introduce yourself briefly. So I'll take right down front, and we'll move it around here.
Thank you. Is this on? Okay. Hi, I'm John Dempsey with the State Department Office of the Special Representative for Afghanistan and Pakistan, and what I'm about to say is not necessarily the view of the State Department. I'm speaking in my own personal capacity, but just to look back a bit at the negotiations in 2014, and I know, Scott, you know, you mentioned how you were appalled at the terms that were included in the political agreement between Ghani and Abdullah. And there were certainly things that were included in there that were, at the time, probably not achievable. But it's important, I think, to remember that the top priority at the time was to have a democratic transition from President Karzai to a successor. And what had happened following the runoff election that summer did not give much confidence that they were going to be able to achieve that transition successfully anytime quickly. And as time moved forward throughout the summer, without any resolution of the crisis, there were fears both here and in other places that Hamid Karzai was going to look to manipulate the political chaos to his advantage and try to somehow remain in power or cobble together some sort of ruling interim caretaker type government where his interests would be of paramount concern, and they wouldn't move to a democratically elected successor. So we were able to get there, I think, successfully. Just the other point I would make quickly is on the difference between the political and the legal and constitutional questions that we're facing. I mean, the political agreement is a political agreement. It's not a constitution. As you've highlighted, there was a five-year term for the president. But in Afghanistan, the reality is that people are often getting bogged down in what's legal and what's constitutional versus what's politically practical. And I think the latter is much more important to keep in mind in terms of finding solutions.
John, I'm going to take that as a comment rather than a question, but thank you for sharing. You want a quick response?
Very quick, yeah. I mean, I knew I would face flak for that comment, and I appreciate all the arguments that Omar has made and that you've made, but I still think it's irresponsible not to raise this point. And it's not an issue that's only related to Afghanistan, but the idea of trying to recreate a political order based on the rule of law, which you know will be violated right off the bat because the conditions are unrealistic, to me, is counterproductive.
Right, gentlemen, right here. Please, short.
Well, Afghanistan.
I know you'd like to give a speech, so please.
Mr. Weinbaum, Afghanistan situation cannot be with short questions.
No. But other people in the audience here who I want to give an opportunity to.
Afghanistan's history goes a long ways. The biggest mistake that has been made in Afghanistan was the West forgot.
Please identify yourself.
I am Ali Siraj. I'm the president of the National Coalition for the Tribes of Afghanistan. I've been involved with the Afghan tribes for the last 14 years, with every single tribe in Afghanistan. And the unfortunate thing is that the West, when they came to Afghanistan, they tried to build Afghanistan the image of the West. Afghanistan cannot be built in anybody's image except in the image of an Afghan. Afghanistan is a nation of tribes. The tribes of Afghanistan has protected and preserved Afghanistan's integrity and independence for centuries. Unfortunately, when the Soviet Union invaded Afghanistan, they broke the structure. And when the West came in, they totally disregarded Afghanistan's tribal structure, which is the foundation, and they started building a roof on imaginary walls. You cannot build a house on imaginary walls. The foundation of Afghanistan are the tribes, and the walls of Afghanistan are the young generation. And both of these have been totally disregarded. And so long as we continue disregarding it, you're not going to have any peace. And one last thing, sir.
Please.
The peace with the Taliban, when they say Taliban, which Taliban are we talking about? Chechens, Saudis, Daesh, which Taliban are we talking about? Show me a Talib leader that can control all the Taliban and bring him to the peace table. I will kiss his feet. There is no such a thing. This is a pipe dream, writing on ice and leaving it in the sun, for God's sake. Why don't we sit down and face reality and the fact of what's going on in Afghanistan? Pakistan is interfering in Afghanistan. We signed a BSA with the United States government. The people of Afghanistan are saying, where is the West? Why aren't we allowed to go to the United Nations and file lodge a complaint at the United Nations National Security? Okay. Why are we allowed for that?
Well, thank you for that valuable comment. well, let's see over here. Right back here. Yeah, still with his hand up, yes.
Hi, Doug Brooks with the Afghan American Chamber of Commerce. And we've been focusing on the political here, but you still have the business side of Afghanistan, which has to successfully function during all this chaos. And yet the business side is willing to do that if some basic aspects of security can be sorted out. And currently with the chaos around the Afghan public protection force and the roles of private security, the business is in turmoil itself, and they're waiting for some sort of direction on this. Is there any chance that could be at least sorted out? All the politics come later.
Would anybody like to address that?
Jalali, would you like to address that?
I think I, in a week or so, my report will be published by USIP, which is focused on Afghan National Defense and Security Forces, mission, capability, and future. Security does not happen in a vacuum. And the national security forces are just one element in providing security in the country. There are political, there are economic, regional, diplomatic dimensions to it. I think the national security forces of Afghanistan in the past 1 year, 1 year and a half, proved that they can hold their own. However, although with the high casualty rate. But it means that if that security forces are used and the capability gaps are plugged by international support, that security forces will be able to guarantee, ensure the survival of the state. That's the key. The more stability comes to the country and security comes to the country, I think then you will have more opportunities, encouragement for people to invest in Afghanistan and also people not to take their money out of it. Okay. So it all depends on the stability of Afghanistan, and the major elements is the political effectiveness of the government and defense and security capability.
And I would add that an important plank in all of this is to effectively fight corruption as well, and to provide an environment where people feel somewhat not only secure from the attacks, but also secure from attacks from civil servants and those who, you know, contractors, whoever it may be, who's involved in bad business practices. I think that this government, one of the things that this government could have done better and has done to some extent, but not as much as they could have, is to fight corruption more effectively.
Let's see. I'll try. I'm looking for a woman. There's one right here.
Lots of women.
I'm Tamana Ahila, and I'm from Women for Afghan Women. I have two questions for the panelists.
Just make it one.
Yeah, very quick. My first question is about the peace talks with the former commander of Hizb Islami Afghanistan, Gulbuddin Hekmatyar. He is willing to join the government of Afghanistan, but only if his requests are fulfilled. And so his name, he wants his name to be removed from the blacklist of the United Nations and the United States. So what's your opinion about that? And my second question is about the model of national united government, because it's not based on the constitution of Afghanistan. We know it was based on Loya Jirga and the vote of people. So is it a successful model for the future elections, or it's just specifically for this 5-year terms of Ghani's presidential period? Thank you.
Anyone?
Quickly, I guess, on the talks with Hekmatyar and the Hizb Islami. I mean, I was in Kabul last week and was sort of asking people generally what this was about. And the elements of the responses I got was, one, it was a question of Hekmatyar growing old and feeling that, you know, he wanted to restore his dignity. Two, it probably wouldn't have that much influence on in terms of levels of violence, because they're not the main perpetrators. Some people wanted to believe that if a deal could be struck between Hekmatyar and the government, it would be a positive demonstration effect to the Taliban that, you know, yes, you can make a deal. But I mean, I think they said it would be announced sort of within a week or so. We'll see what the terms are. But I do think, and Omar, you may have views on this also, that it may put some stress on the government, depending on what the conditions are. It sort of does seem to certain people as well. It's just quite a good reward for having fought a long time against the government. But let's see what the details are in the deal.
Ali?
Yeah, I think if you look at the history of Afghanistan, I think the finally settlement of rebellions comes incrementally, not in one package. Maybe we will be very optimistic to assume that one day all these opposing parties will sit around a table and sign a peace agreement. It will come incrementally, maybe locally. With Hekmatyar, you have to look at this kind of condition. I think Hekmatyar has some fighters in Afghanistan. However, what conditions? I think you should obey the constitution of Afghanistan when he integrates his people into Afghanistan, it should be on the basis of the established rules in Afghanistan, not to take some kind of a political advantage. And, you know, in Afghanistan, all rebellions failed as long as the government had some kind of a support from outside. Twice, national governments failed when there was no outside support. One was in 1920s, the King Amanullah's government, and once in 1990s, when the United States and the international community disengaged from Afghanistan. Otherwise, governments always were able to defeat rebellions. And this is not a kind of, although this rebellion has some support from Pakistan and some other countries, but as a principle, the history of Afghanistan shows that rebellions can be defeated by the government as long as that government is not left alone by its international partners.
Let me add that I can't think of a more unsavory character in all of Afghan history than Gulbuddin Hekmatyar. Now, we haven't had a Pakistani voice, and there's one back there, Dr. Nisar, who is anxious to speak. And as I say, we do need a Pakistani. So, Dr. Nisar, briefly.
Thank you very much. I'll be the most brief as compared to all the people who asked questions before. I am Dr. Nisar Chaudhry with Pakistan American League. Thank you very much, Marvin, for arranging such a great panel. And it was so insightful, very helpful. Mr. Jalali mentioned about unity, and this is something which is ideal. And I think we need to become more pragmatic than we should stick to the idealism. And Mr. Scott mentioned about that Pakistan is not willing to bring Taliban on the negotiating table. Pakistan does have influence, some degree of influence and contact with some of the Talibans, but they have no control over them. And Pakistan's own plate is full, and Pakistan fully understands that stability in Pakistan and stability in Afghanistan are interdependent. So I don't find any incentive for Pakistan to see Afghanistan destabilized. Mike had been very, Kugelman, had been very optimistic. It was like somebody who was pushed over the Empire State Building, and when he was halfway down, somebody looked through the window and asked him, "How are you doing?" He said, "So far, so good." So this is too optimistic. I think the reality, it doesn't change the reality. I think my question is, are these Talibans gaining ground, losing ground, are being marginalized, and can there be any kind of a government which is broadly based in presence of rule of law without incorporating the Taliban in the system or without sharing power with them? Thank you very much.
About the Taliban. Yeah.
Ali. Can I? I think that if you look at the record for the past 15 years at least, Afghan leaders have made every attempt to ask the Taliban to come and join everybody else. I mean, I don't recall any time when this has not been done. At the beginning, we missed some chances. I agree there were some opportunities that were missed at the beginning when it would have been probably the best time to do so. But later on, there was a realization that we need to come to terms with this particular group that continues to fight and has access to sanctuaries, has access to funding, has access to all types of software and hardware outside of Afghanistan, and obviously recruitment outside of Afghanistan. Now, I think that at this moment, the Taliban are probably portraying an image of strength. But I think that inherently, they are probably at one of their weakest points ever. That's my assessment. And I believe that not only are they politically somewhat in disarray, the leadership is not united anymore. But I think that over the past few weeks, they have been facing some major assaults and some major losses on the battlefield. The problem of Afghanistan is not just what you or the media calls the Afghan Taliban. The problem of Afghanistan goes beyond the Afghan Taliban. It involves many other elements that are not Afghan and who are in one way or another linked to the Taliban and have been for 22 years. Sometimes these linkages seem weak and sometimes very strong, depending on the politics of the day. And so the problem with Afghanistan is that we need to fight all of these different elements, some now under the name of IS, Islamic State, Daesh, others under other names, and people coming from all over. Most of them are people who had retreated back into the tribal regions of Afghanistan after the Taliban were overthrown, whether they are Al-Qaeda type, or whether they're Pakistani Taliban type, or whether they are Arab, other Arab or other Middle Eastern, or whatever you want, you know, whatever connection they had. And they had sanctuaries in Pakistan's tribal regions going back to the 80s and 90s. Now most of them find themselves back in Afghanistan for some odd reason. Not odd, part of some planned reason. So this is a situation as I see it, and I think that as long as the Afghan forces are able to not only contain the Taliban, but also put pressure on them to maybe lose some momentum, then we will be closer to a peace deal. The more you put pressure on them, the closer we will get to a peace deal.
Okay. Of course, what we do have to be concerned with the two sides being weak, which one fades first? So that's now this is going to have to be our last question. I'm going to take a woman back here again. I always get criticized for this.
I'm glad I wore pink today instead of black.
I'm very sensitive.
So especially, and we have, the two of us are sitting next to each other, so maybe I should pass the mic to the person sitting next to me. My name is Liz Wilson. I work for an NGO here in DuPont Circle. We're working on a higher education project in Afghanistan right now. And with the departure of a lot of young, qualified, educated Afghans, I'm just wondering what are some ways that the government might be having some strategies to try to keep their young people in the country during this time of transition? There's been so much money. Our organization, FHI 360, it's called, has been working for nearly a decade in higher education in Afghanistan. So there's been a lot of investment trying to keep young people there. But just from our staff who I work with on up to ministers, it just seems like there's a big struggle. So just from your perspective on the youth and education, the state of education in Afghanistan.
Who do you
want? Ali or?
Well, you cannot build walls around Afghanistan to prevent these people to leave. I think they should have incentives. In the next 4 years, I think 4 million more Afghans will hit the job market. Unless you provide incentive for jobs and also a future, I think it will be very difficult to prevent that exodus of Afghan educated people. But fortunately, in the past 14 years, thousands and thousands of Afghans were educated, both inside the country and outside Afghanistan. So there are still many, many talents in Afghanistan. The capacity is not rare in Afghanistan. Only the approaches to use these capacities have been inadequate. So yes, I think the unemployment, decline in economic situation, security, and ineffectiveness of the government, corruption, other things, are issues that probably provide incentive for people to leave the country. Otherwise, many people would be happy to have a job, to work in their own country. Unless you provide these opportunities, unfortunately, you cannot prevent the exodus of Afghan educated from Afghanistan, like many other countries as well.
You know, I'm going to apologize for not being able to entertain every question. And I'm also going to apologize to the panel, because I don't know about you, but I have a feeling they were just getting started. There is so much that they have to share with us, and I think we've just skimmed the surface here. So I want you to join me, if you will, in thanking this superb panel, and thank you for coming.